So without further ado, I'd really like to hand over to Lynn Laidlaw, who's been involved in co-production for a long time now and has been there as using co-production as an approach to research as a patient and public contributor. Lynn, I won't steal any more of your thunder, so over to you now. Thanks.
That's great. Thanks, Dawn. So I've prepared some slides. So just to start, I want to tell you a little about myself and the context in which I'm involved in co-production. So I live with a rare autoimmune rheumatic disease and multiple long-term conditions. And I'm involved in co-production as a patient and public contributor and also patient researcher in health research. That is how I am happy to describe myself. But I understand that there are many different terms are used across co-production, but these are the ones I will use in this presentation. And I'll also talk about PPI, which is patient and public involvement. Although my talk concentrates on health research, I believe the values and principles underlying co-production are the same, regardless of the context. And what I'm mainly going to do is talk about the findings from the value of co-production project I was involved with, and also shared some reflections from my experiences co-producing a qualitative research project on the experiences of people shielding from COVID-19 who live with inflammatory arthritis and autoimmune rheumatic diseases. I had to shield for that reason. Next slide, please, Sam. So the value of co-production research project was funded with money from Research England's Participatory Research Fund, which was given to universities. And the co-production collective, who are based at University College London, managed to access their allocation to fund this mixed methods research project. And although I was involved across the project, I was mainly involved with co-producing the rapid systematic review into the value of co-production, which asked what are the different types of co-production within research and what are their values. Next slide, please, Sam. So why the value of co-production project? And I suspect that many of you can identify with the reasons why this project was needed. And we wanted to provide the answers to these and other commonly asked questions and challenges. You know, why should we co-produce research services and policies? What is the evidence base? What is the impact of co-production? And we wanted to provide evidence answers, but crucially in a co-produced values-led way. Next slide, please. And I'm not going to say much about the methods other than we were focused on the co-production of research and papers that explicitly used the term co-production. And we concentrated on papers published in 21 and 22 and looked at health, social care, education, arts and cultures. And I should mention at this stage that I developed what I later found out was termed reviewer rage when we were reading and coding these papers, as many of them only mentioned co-production in passing and didn't provide any evidence of the process. There was much of what has been termed conceptual stretching, and this is billing things as co-production when they weren't. We also know it as full production. Also, there was much co-biquity, which means like putting co in front of everything, co-development, co-design, co-reporting, without actually defining what occurred. Next slide, please, Sam. And as the title of the project suggests, we were explicitly looking for the mention of the values associated with co-production in the papers we reviewed. And we identified 18 values, and I'm sure they will resonate with people in the room. And there was no single definition. But overarching this, the context in which the co-production occurred was also important. Next slide, please. So how were the values enacted and put into practice or not? And it probably won't be surprising that the papers that we have termed the richest co-production were themselves co-authored. But the extent to which co-production vision was executed varied. We found 13 papers that claimed that they had used co-production, but they had actually used other approaches in patient public involvement. And it was challenging to make a judgment whilst not wanting to be seen as the co-production police. And very few of the papers described co-production happening through all parts of the research cycle, which was really disappointing. At best, there could be what's termed pockets of co-production. And to me, this begs the question, how do we co-produce and who makes the decisions about the extent to which people become involved? Who holds the power here? Next slide, please. And we found that the unexplored impacts of co-production were as follows. And although we commented on academic culture, I suspect that the culture and service position and policy are similar. And I think it could be challenging to constantly put your head above the parapet and push back against academic and other culture, as we all do on a regular basis. Next slide, please. So these were the overarching observations from the review, and I'll cover them in more detail later. But before I do so, I want to say a little about how we modelled co-production values in our project. Next slide. So how did we co-produce this rapid systematic review? So we were a team of 4 academics and 2 public contributors. And it was a fantastic experience, but not without its challenges. At one point, Anne, who was the other co-producer involved, and myself were worried that we had broken the review. And I think it was really important for us to acknowledge that we brought different types of knowledge and experience to the table, but everything was value. We made time for reflexive discussions, and I'll talk a bit more about that later. We challenged ourselves and each other, which is so important. And it took us time to build relationships based on trust and mutual respect. And these don't happen overnight. We decided roles and then put together. And crucially, we co-authored the final report. And peppered through the report, which I'll share in the chat later, were the reflections of the whole team and just the discussions that we had about the finding. And that's quite unusual in a rapid systematic review. Next slide, please, Sam. So a deeper dive into the findings. We found that co-production is a complex methodology. And the important thing about this finding is that co-production needs resources, planning, evaluation, and reporting as a result. The values underpinning co-production are important as they are the mechanism through which change can be achieved. And my favourite finding is that in co-production, the journey is as important as the destination. And we need to evidence that and describe it as well. And interestingly, in the papers we looked at where the journey was mentioned, it was mostly in relation to the people with lived experience, not the researchers. But I feel we are all in a journey when we co-produce. But how often is that recognised? In both projects I've been involved with, I learnt valuable skills that I've utilised in other projects. And do we currently recognise that? Next slide. And we also found the following, which I've termed as more challenges. And I think the question about funding and resources is vital. People with lived experience aren't free goods. Equality and understanding power differentials is fundamental to the practice of co-production. And what power do people with lived experience have over whether they will be offered remuneration for their time or not? And this fits with my experience of being told that I'm part of something that is co-produced, but having my request for reasonable expenses declined, or on a few occasions being made to feel greedy for asking. And I believe this impacts directly on inclusivity and diversity. Are the only people who can co-produce those who can afford to? Doing things online isn't cost-free, but is that recognised? And this is about offering payment, and people can then choose whether they wish to accept it or not. Conversations about money are uncomfortable, but they're a nettle we need to grasp. And is it ever true co-production when professionals are being paid, but those with lived experience aren't? And I think some of the other issues are, where does co-production start? When we co-produced our research into shielding, it was myself and another public contributor, Joyce, who came up with the idea. And we were supported by a research unit based at Manchester University. The conversation started because we were both part of a COVID-19 patient public involvement group. And I feel this underlines the importance of making spaces for conversation and collaboration, allowing relationships to grow and co-production to evolve. Not just researchers and services deciding that something will be co-produced and then involving people with lived experience once everything has been decided. And I think that co-production challenges identity. It certainly challenged my identity. I can't unlearn the skills and experiences that I have gained, but how much of our identity is tied up in how others perceive us? Is everyone willing to work in a non-hierarchical way and leave our titles at the door? Culture eats strategy for breakfast. Governments and organisations may say that they want to co-produce, but are they willing to meet the challenges that this may bring? When we evaluate co-production projects, from whose perspectives are we doing this? Do we recognise that people can have multiple identities, skills and experiences? What are our experiences of people with lived experience? Is that all we expect from them? Do we leave the more technical skills, such as analysing data and making policy decisions, to the experts? And I think when evaluating the impact that co-production makes, that needs to be co-produced too. It shouldn't be done to us. Next slide, please, Sam. So I just wanted to share some personal reflections. And I think the more co-production projects I've become involved with, the more I've realised that reflexive practice is essential when co-producing. And that's examining one's own thoughts, feelings, actions, and their impact and how that biases us. And it's essential for co-production. And again, this can be challenging and uncomfortable, but it begs the question, can everyone co-produce, or should people have enough self-knowledge to recognise that they can't work in a values-driven way, working together in equal partnership for equal benefit? And I think we need to ask ourselves that question. And if we don't feel that we can work in this way, then we should leave co-production to the people who can, because there are unintended consequences. You know, we all come, I think, especially when you're coming with your lived experience, that can be really emotional. And if you're not part of a meaningful process, then that it can really impact on us. And I think I've learned that I don't need to be involved in all parts of a co-produced project, but that shouldn't be decided for people. In our shielding research, Charlotte, who's a clinical academic, came on board to be our principal investigator. And that made sense because she had a contract and she was able to navigate things like the ethics process and whatever that needed people with a contract who were involved, who were employed directly by the university to do that. And projects need to be led, but hierarchies need to be flat. And I feel we need to recognise what I call the joys and challenges of co-production, especially with regard to identity and imposter syndrome. I had massive imposter syndrome, especially when we were doing our shielding research, because I was doing the interviews and I was analysing the data. And I kind of thought, well, you know, who am I? Because I don't have any formal research training to do this. And it took me a long time to overcome that. And that impacted on the way that the team worked. And I think that people are more than the lived experience, and individuals need investment as well as projects. And I have learned so much from the projects that I've been involved with. And I was lucky in that I was privileged to be able to invest time and energy in my own development to enable me to be part of these projects. And how do we flatten the hierarchy? How do we enable people to take up these opportunities when they maybe don't have the experiences that I do? And the next slide, please, Sam. And I just wanted to end with the overall findings from the value of co-production project. And it delivers outcomes that actually matters to people. I think although people say that it takes time and resources to set up, I think it's an efficient method in the long run. Using co-production, we can work towards social justice. People say that it empowers them and it can build capacity. But I think we need to be explicit about what we mean by empowering. And if people say that they're empowered, then that's different from us saying that we have empowered people. And I think it connects us as humans working towards shared goals. And I just want to thank you for the opportunity to present. I hope that the findings resonate with people and that I've maybe brought up some provocations that we might think about in the breakout room. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Lynn. I'm sure everyone will agree that's a great start to our conversations this morning and some real food for thought there. I love that you pulled out that the journey is as important as the destination, and also that people are more than their lived experience. Please do use the chat to put in your questions if there's anything there that Lynn has sparked that you really want to pull up for the question session later. Without any further ado, we're going to pass on to Pat Scrutton, who's from the Intergenerational National Network, who's going to tell us about a co-production process that she's been involved with Dundee University. So over to you, Pat.
Thank you. I'm going to break up the PowerPoint by quite simply telling you a story. And I believe that my story will reflect many of the things that Lynn has been talking about, because it is a story of a journey. But before I tell you the story, I do indeed coordinate the Intergenerational National Network, and I like to draw parallels between networking and co-production. So when we invite people into a network, we ask them to bring with them themselves, their experience, their skills, their knowledge, and to leave at the door their baggage. So their job titles, their status, their assumptions, their prejudices. And then when they come into the room, what they do, they share all of the things they have brought with them, and they learn from each other. And co-production for me is very similar to that. And I think what also you get from both of those things is you get incredibly rich conversations and that shared learning. So my story, once upon a time, I met through network connections, a professor called Judith, and that is her real name. And we met for coffee in Dundee, and we just began to talk, and her research interest is in aging in place. So how do we keep people at home or in a home environment as long as we can? And one of my passions is intergenerational practice. So we dreamed up a research project, and we, in order to realize that, we brought together in a room in Dundee, real room, this is pre-COVID, a number of academics from not just Dundee, but also from Heriot Watt and Stirling. And their expertise covered gerontology, urban planning, design, housing. And we also brought into the room what we call community members. So we had Petra Biba back from Planning Aid Scotland, PASS, a very experienced youth worker who has a lot of experience in intergenerational practice, and a couple of other older people. So together, we designed a research plan. And this was to look at how do we make places and spaces, inside and outside, welcoming, accessible, affordable, enjoyable, comfortable, and fun for people of all generations. Then we looked around for funding, and we were funded by the Scottish University Insight Institute, SUI. So the original plan, which they agreed, was to hold 6 workshops in community venues across Scotland during 2020. And you will know that the beginning of 2020 was when COVID hit. So we had to go back to the drawing board. And we said to Sui, look, you know, this is what we want to do, we can't do it. And Sui said, okay, let's think how we can do it. So they were very supportive. And we simply redesigned it. And we ran the workshops virtually. Now, the downside of that obviously was we lost all of that contact that you get when you sit down and have a coffee together and have a conversation. You sit down and have lunch together and you have a conversation. However, what we gained was the fact that we actually had quite a lot of international partners from Canada, China, India, Slovenia, Denmark, and we were all able to join in the virtual room. So although we lost the informal conversations, the actual conversations we had were incredibly rich. In the meantime, we had been invited to present at an international conference in Quebec, the International Association for People and Environment. So it's an organization that looks at people and place, which is obviously where we were coming from. And we had built in funding into the project for one of the researchers and me, as the official person with lived experience, to go and present at this conference. But of course, obviously COVID again got in the way. So I did spend a week in Quebec. Unfortunately, it was sitting precisely where you see me now on my sofa, which was disappointing. But the fact is that they had built in that funding in a lovely way. So basically, I was involved in this project from the word go, from the conception, through the design, through running the workshop. And then once the project was complete, because it was quite a short project, it was just a year, we started writing up the findings. And I was, as Lynn's describing, obviously the researchers have skills that we don't, but in as far as I was prepared to be and could be involved, I was involved in writing up the findings, and not only my name, but the name of all the community people involved are on every paper that has come out of that project. So everyone is completely co-authored. And now we're embarking on a new project. So this is very much a journey. So we developed such a strong working relationship through the development of, I should have said, called Age-Friendly Living Ecosystem was the project. We really didn't want to let that go. We didn't want to lose that. We were determined to keep it going. So we did a couple of short pieces of research that were funded internally through the University of Dundee. And then we discovered that the Economic and Social Research Council, the ESRC, had put out a call for projects looking at inclusive aging. Now, conversation for another day. Why is inclusive aging all about older people? In my opinion, inclusive aging should be about everybody. Different conversation. But we put in a bid, and our bid was, it had to be, they were very specific. It had to be with marginalized communities or people who are perceived as marginalized. And so we have focused on older people with learning disabilities and older people who identify as LGBTQIA+. I'm getting better at that. And we were successful. They originally said they'd fund 10 projects. They actually funded 6. And of the 6, 2 are in Scotland, which is a huge accolade for Scotland. We are working across the UK. We are the principal investigators in Dundee, but our partners are the University of Hertfordshire and the University of Wolverhampton. So we're very much extending that networking. And we are also going to build in community advisory groups. And we are also going to employ some co-researchers from those two groups who will be paid co-researchers. We'll also have the opportunity, and I'm coming back to my networking theme now, we'll also have the opportunity to network across the 6 projects. We've already had one meeting, which is hugely positive. I think people, you know, when you're up for funding, it's so competitive. And I think it was lovely to be in a situation where these people who had been competing against each other were able to say, well, now we can collaborate. So I think this, you know, there are so many elements to this in terms of collaboration, co-production. And I will personally be very interested to see to what extent the other projects we're working with actually have a co-production approach. So to finish, the reason I chose this particular example, and I do have others, is because I believe it shows that it is possible, although challenging, to build in co-production from day one. You need the will and you need the right people in place, but it is possible. And then I think illustrating another thing that Lynn was talking about is the huge importance of developing those really good, mutually respectful working relationships where everybody understands that everybody else around the table is contributing something that might be different to what they're contributing, that is equally valued and valuable. And throughout this process, I must say, I have felt completely valued. So that's me. I'm happy to answer questions. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to run away slightly early, so I won't be around at the end. But I've said to SCDC that I'm very happy for my email to be shared. So if anybody wants to come back to me afterwards, happy to talk about any of that in more detail. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pat. That was fabulous. Again, it's just that importance of building good, respectful relationships, coming together. And that I love that bit about never underestimating the power of a cuppa. It's a really important tool for us working together. Thank you for that. And I really can't wait to hear about the new project as it develops. So, you know, for folk that are listening today and hopefully gathering up loads and loads of questions, please do pop them into the chat. And we'll come back to that after we've heard from our final speaker this morning, who is Amy Watson, the Principal Research Officer for Open Government at the Scottish Government. And Amy's going to talk about the practices that what the Scottish Government are putting in place at the moment to support those participatory practices and looking at the challenges and opportunities that brings along. So I'll hand over to Amy now.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here today. I'm going to give a brief overview of some participatory work that Scottish Government has been doing for a while, has got coming up, some of our aspirations with regards to taking a more participatory approach. And then I was going to end with a couple of questions that it would be really helpful for me to get some understanding on from the group, and hopefully this will build on what Pat and Lynn were also talking about. So here's a sort of potted list of some of the participatory work that's been going on in Scottish Government recently. I'm sure a lot of you will be familiar with at least aspects of this, and I should say the Open Government team is currently developing a coordinated overview of all the participatory work that's taking place across Scottish Government. So we think it's really important that we have a clearer handle on this. Obviously, there's a really diverse range of approaches and projects and policy areas that feature something like co-production, participatory approaches. And we could certainly have a conversation at the end, I think, about that, the kind of spectrum of that work and what people feel is sort of satisfactory or not in terms of a participatory approach or a co-productive approach. So I'm sure you're familiar with some of these examples. I'll just go through them quickly. Quite long standing, we've had the Social Security Scotland experience and client panels. The experience panels were set up a few years ago, and the client panels are a slightly more recent addition, and those are designed to provide kind of ongoing input and innovation in terms of people who are claiming Social Security from Social Security Scotland. So that's for the benefits that are devolved to the Scottish Government. We also have People's Panel for Wellbeing. That's a kind of relatively new addition. So I think that was set up this year. It's had about four sessions so far. A key focus for that panel has been COVID and COVID recovery, but also talking about other issues that are a priority for people. So like the cost of living crisis has been a big one. I'm sure you're all aware of the development of the new National Care Service and various bits of work that have taken to an extent a participatory approach in terms of developing that. And also the promise that was made to care experienced children and young people. Looking back a little bit further, we've run two citizen assemblies. So the Citizen Assembly of Scotland and then Scotland's Climate Assembly. We also held a citizen's jury on QCOVID, the algorithm and the ethics around that. And a couple of years ago, there was a mini public on post-Brexit rural priorities in Scotland. So as I said, that's not everything. We're trying to develop a more kind of coordinated overview of what's taking place in SG, but that maybe gives you a sense of some of the kind of prominent pieces of work that have been taking place. Next slide, please. So this is just an overview of the commitments that Scottish Government's made for this Parliament that are relevant to co-production and participation. And these featured in Manifesto, the Bute House Agreement and the Programme for Government. So we've got a commitment to a local deliberative engagements that culminate in a National Citizens Assembly on the topic of local government funding. The establishment of an annual Citizens Assembly to look at some of the more complex issues that we face the country. The establishment of a Citizens Assembly for people aged under 16 to ensure that the voices of the future are heard. And a COVID recovery strategy that puts people at the heart of everything we do and takes a person-centred approach. And there's also a more general commitment to the increased use of participatory processes to aid what we're calling the transformation of the work of government. So some of you might have heard this term public service reform, with the intention that the public are involved in decisions which affect them and which are important to them. Next slide, please. So to deliver on some of these commitments, we recognise that we need some new infrastructure and some new processes. And in order to begin the process of developing that, the IPDD working group was set up in summer 2021. It's such a mouthful to say institutionalising participatory and deliberative democracy. That's what IPDD stands for. I will just say IPDD, that's what I'm referring to. So the working group was made up of a range of different experts and practitioners that have experience, knowledge in the field of participation, deliberative democracy. And they worked throughout kind of the end of summer, autumn and winter 2021. And the report from the working group was published in March 2022. And it makes 19 recommendations across two key themes, embedding a range of participatory and democratic innovations, which can then be used as a basis to establish routine use of citizens' assemblies in Scotland. So there's a link to the report in the slides. I'm sure you'll all get the slides after this session. In the most recent programme for government, so the one published a couple of months ago, SG committed to publishing a response to the IPDD working group. And this will set out how we can involve people and communities, government, children and young people in democratic decision making, and will respond to each of the recommendations in turn. Next slide, please. So I'm a social researcher, which doesn't necessarily mean loads to people who don't work in the Scottish Government, but people within the Scottish Government are organised into professions, and social research is one of those. And within that profession, we've been doing quite a lot of work on some of the practicalities around ethically involving people in social research that is taking place within government, but that also is commissioned. And one of the priority issues that we've been looking at is the payment of participants. So we're working to establish a consistent process for remunerating people who are taking part in participatory research. And I mean that as a kind of catch-all for co-production and that kind of spectrum of longer form pieces of work, panels, things that ask quite a lot of time from people, that are asking them to input their expertise in a way that is clearly comparable to like so-called kind of professional expertise. It's our intention that this will include comprehensive expenses and payment for participant time. And we want this payment to be offered to participants in a range of forms that suit them. And that can include vouchers or a cash payment. I know this is a sticky issue for a lot of people. As far as we know, payment in vouchers should not pose difficulty for people who are claiming any benefits from DWP, but we are clarifying details on this. As some of you might be aware, there is a public statement from HMRC that confirms that cash payment for participant time taking part in research projects is not classified as earned income and is therefore not taxable up to a reasonable threshold. And we're currently working with DWP to establish a comparable public position with regards to cash payment. As I'm sure a lot of you are aware, it's a real priority for us to engage with people who are marginalised, and many people who are marginalised are dealing with the DWP system in some way. And we need to make sure that those individuals can be inclusively involved in the work that we're doing, and the ambiguity around payment and the interaction of that payment with DWP benefits is a big problem for us. So watch this space, we are trying to resolve that. Next slide, please. We're also doing some longer term work around ethics and training within the social research profession within the Scottish Government. So some of you might be aware of the social research ethics process that we follow whenever a piece of social research is commissioned or is conducted in-house. And we think there's some details there in terms of ensuring that it's appropriate for participatory work, co-production. Historically, this isn't an approach that Scottish Government has taken in terms of how it works with research participants, how it conducts research. So we think it's really important that we update some of the kind of established processes we have to make sure that we're doing this to the highest ethical standard. We're also developing plans for participation lived experience training for Scottish Government social researchers to take place next year. And the intention is that that will give people a broad understanding of what co-production looks like and a range of methods kind of around that, how that can fit in with the responsibilities of the social research role. And we'll then go into some more detail in terms of maybe some specific approaches, methods, working with different people and on different kinds of issues. And that'll be tailored for people who have got this kind of work coming up in their role over the next couple of years. And next slide, please. So I had some questions for you that we don't have to talk about right now. So obviously I think lots of people have questions already in the chat. But this is to give you a sense of, I suppose, some of the questions that we're asking ourselves within SG, within social research in particular. As I'm sure you're aware, there are a lot of budget challenges this year. We always need to make choices anyway about what we prioritise in terms of the methods, the time we're going to take on a piece of work, the issues that need new evidence, where we already have evidence that we can draw on instead. So we want to make sure that we're using the right method at the right time, especially when evidence input or shared decision making is needed. So it'd be helpful for me to get an understanding from you all about the types of issues or the types of situations that you think it's most useful for SG to undertake co-production, or broadly speaking, a participatory approach. Because we can't do it for everything, and we want to do it when it's really, really useful and when it's going to work really well and have a lot of impact. Are there policy areas, for example, where you think that's really needed? Or are there types of issues or situations where it's most useful for SG to engage with lived experience as a type of evidence, but not as part of a wider co-production approach? So that's maybe kind of quite a sticky question that's getting kind of more into the territory of, I suppose, traditional qualitative research. Just kind of thinking about the spectrum of options that we have available to us. And when we can take an approach that's going to be most useful and have the most impact. So that's all from me. Thanks, everyone. And happy to have a discussion.